With a Canadian federal election coming up, and the reigning Conservative Party facing a lot of criticism and hostile sentiments, the question its members have to confront is, what will this party become? Can it keep going the way it's been going, or does it have to change its form somehow? Many people think the next Conservative Party leader will be Jason Kenney, a devout Catholic, so there's someone to keep an eye on. If he does end up inheriting the mantle from Stephen Harper, he will have to decide which direction to take the Conservative Party. At present, probably the Conservatives' main marketing strategy is to present themselves as being good for the economy, for cutting taxes and international trade deals alike, and its rhetoric is free market and business-oriented. But acclaimed Canadian author, feminist, and activist Margaret Atwood has written a piece for the National Post putting forward Preston Manning as the, quote, man of the future. It may seem odd that a left-wing sort like Atwood would extol the virtues of Manning, the founder of the right-wing Western Canadian Reform Party, which ended up absorbing the Tories and which furnished Canadian politics with Harper and Kenney in the first place. Yet Manning, who stood against the Kyoto Protocol and in defense of the Western economy, which is fueled, if you'll pardon the pun, largely by oil, has unashamedly called for a green conservatism, a conservatism which includes conservation. This raises the point about what it means to be a conservative or a Tory in the first place. Now, there are various definitions that can be offered of a Tory. Samuel Johnson defined a Tory as, quote, one who adheres to the ancient constitution of the state and the apostolical hierarchy of the Church of England. Enoch Powell defined it thusly, a Tory is a person who regards authority as immanent in institutions. John Henry Newman called Toryism loyalty to persons, and Walter Bagehot said that the essence of Toryism is enjoyment. The way to keep up old customs, he explained, is to enjoy old customs. The way to be satisfied with the present state of things is to enjoy that state of things, end quote. The general picture that emerges is of loyalty and enjoyment of the established institutions, and the more ancient and ecclesial they are, the better. Now, there are different kinds of Tories. The American conservative writer Russell Kirk called himself a bohemian Tory, defining a bohemian as a wandering or impecunious man of arts and letters, and the author Evelyn Waugh called himself an old-fashioned Tory. But in the Canadian context, an important tradition which we should pay heed to is the presence of what the socialist Gad Horowitz called the Red Tory, which he defined as meaning a Tory who also believed in socialism. And his example of a Red Tory was the philosopher of religion, George Parkin Grant. Grant, most famously the author of Lament for a Nation, is known as the father of Canadian nationalism, a man who feared that Canada's character and political independence was being swallowed up and that it was essentially becoming a satellite of the United States. In many ways, commentators have noted how politically prescient he was, but before he was a political commentator, he was a philosopher, and in some ways, before he was a philosopher, he was a theologian. And Red Toryism, indeed perhaps Toryism in general, cannot be understood apart from Grant's brand of Anglican Platonism. Now, Lament for a Nation was written in response to the 1963 federal election in which Lester Pearson's Liberals defeated John Diefenbaker's Conservatives. During the Cuban Missile Crisis, JFK had ordered Canada to station Bismarck warheads on its soil, and Diefenbaker was bold enough to stand up to him. Although Grant had a lot of problems with Diefenbaker and devoted the entire second chapter of his book to documenting them, he deeply admired Dief for defending Canada's independence in this fashion. Yet this last gasp of Canadian nationalism against the technocratic imperialism of America was to be Diefenbaker's undoing. Pearson, a United Nations internationalist whose views were much closer to Kennedy's, defeated Diefenbaker and overnight Canada was once again a lackey of America. This, Grant thought, was the end of Canada's long-shot chance at preserving her independence, hence his treatise is a lament for a lost dream. It wasn't just that Diefenbaker had lost to Pearson, it was that conservatism had lost to liberalism. Liberalism, as Grant defined it, is a belief that everything which obstructs the fulfillment of human desires should be removed. It extols liberty over virtue. It stands for the triumph of the will. Conservatism, on the other hand, represents self-denial, self-discipline, and loyalty to a community, to a network of traditions and institutions. America was founded, Grant thought, on principles of liberalism, whereas Canada was founded by English Protestant Orangemen and ultramontane French Catholics who may have hated each other, but who both feared being absorbed into the homogenizing liberal forces of America and jointly created Canada in order to preserve their respective conservative societies. Grant was himself a conservative. He believed that loyalty to something outside of oneself was the beginning of wisdom, It was the first step on the road towards loving God. This was why he defended nationalism and what he often called the love of one's own. This was why he wanted to protect the existence of Canada and her institutions as something to be loyal to. Yet he ultimately believed that liberalism was destined to defeat conservatism, and that in the final analysis, Canada, as a conservative project in a liberal age, was always destined to fail. Why? Because of technology. Grant's views on technology were influenced by the French anarchist theologian Jacques Ellul, who wrote about the technological society, and by Martin Heidegger, who helped him view technology as not merely a set of external tools, but as an ontology. Technology actually shaped the way we view the world. It becomes our reality. Technology, or technique, is about accomplishing what we desire. Think about what the word technique means, and you will realize this is true. In a technological society, our whole reality becomes the accomplishment of our desires. It is the triumph of the will. And thus, anything which obstructs our will, the traditional demands of family, religion, or nationalism, become increasingly irrelevant and even unintelligible to a technological society. As Marx put it, everything that is solid melts into air. For example, Grant points to multinational corporations, which seek profit wherever they can find it, and are not content to just do business in Canada. He points out that to Canadian business tycoons like E.P. Taylor, Canadian nationalism was entirely incoherent. Why would you deprive yourself of profit just for the sake of exhibiting loyalty to a nation? Grant links capitalism closely with technology, which is part of where his socialism comes from. But he also points to the fact that traditional morality is eroded by technology. Think about the laws against divorce, which seem increasingly restrictive and repressive to our society. Why would you deprive people of a chance to be happy and be involved with whoever they want based on an abstraction like a religious oath they made in their youth? Thus, Grant sees technology as both the source of both economic liberalism and moral liberalism. Moreover, he sees technology as homogenizing. The most effective technology will be the technology that is used everywhere, and this will erode the distinctive characters of different nations and cultures. In this way, Grant anticipated much of the modern criticism of globalism and the McDonaldization of the world, a fact which is celebrated by some. As Grant put it more than once, in a liberal, technologized world, no one will mind whether you make love to men, women, or dogs, as long as you do it in identical Holiday Inns from coast to coast. Furthermore, I suspect that Grant would identify it as pure liberalism that Brits and Canadians debate about whether the monarchy or the Senate works anymore. This is why he thought that Canada, which was once a conservative nation, would eventually resemble America, the vanguard of technological liberalism. In his later writings, Grant modified his views. America would perhaps be loyal to her own traditions, and would ironically end up more conservative than Canada, which was not so deeply rooted in her own institutions and liberalized faster than America did. Thus, technology erodes nationalism and therefore conservatism. And for Grant, this is disastrous for humans, since, as mentioned, he believes, following the ancient philosophers, that a form of political loyalty is necessary for the good life. Yet he believes there is no way to stop technology. It is, as mentioned, an ontology, a way of being. Besides, even if one could arrest the spread of technology, Luddism is unacceptable, because technology does, in fact, improve people's lives. One cannot stop the sick from being cured by medical technology based on a fear of the future. Yet because of this fact, we are trapped on a road towards a dystopian society, predicted by Leo Strauss as the universal homogeneous superstate, as people identify more with international cosmopolitan liberalism than with their own communities. And since it will be based on the satisfaction of whims, it will look a lot like Huxley's Brave New World. Grant pointed out that the human body can itself be an impediment to our desires, hence he warned that transhumanism would inevitably result, and humans would be turned into semi-machines. He already saw signs of this in the legalization of abortion and euthanasia, which were based on the hunt for pleasure rather than virtue, which technology fosters. Technology is inherently violent and in this sense imperialistic. Grant thought it was no coincidence that, when Germany was the most technologically advanced country, it was a German who saw the future was will to power. Grant's nightmare resembles something of the predictions of Agatha Christie, the mystery writer whose Burkean conservatism rebelled at progress, and whose novel Passenger to Frankfurt predicted that one day a technology would be developed to make people docile and benevolent, and that society would be forced to use it in an effort to stop social destruction, even though it would lead to a dystopia. Grant thought the only way to interrupt this process was to slow the speed of technology's spread by means of controlling the economy and restricting foreign investment and trade. He pointed out that it was conservatives who had introduced many of Canada's national institutions, such as Ontario Hydro, which of course is now being privatized by a Liberal government, the CBC, the Bank of Canada, and the Canadian National Railway, which was also privatized by a Liberal government. Grant thought that the Canadian government should nationalize more industries and restrict free trade in order to protect Canada's national character and integrity. In this sense, he could be reckoned not so much as a specific brand of red Tory, but simply as a traditional old-fashioned Tory, a believer in the kind of Toryism which was often opposed to the free market. His proposals did have a lot in common with the economic policies of the NDP, which he had helped found along with Tommy Douglas, and some of what he suggested was attempted by Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau, but noticed two things. One was that he admitted freely that implementing socialistic policies would hurt Canada's economy, but he said it was worth it, a necessary sacrifice in order to prolong the country's life. Secondly, he wanted these policies implemented in order to protect a traditional conservative religious society, not to protect Canada's integrity in order so that it could become a universalistic liberal bastion. But this was exactly what Trudeau, who was the self-described citizen of the world and anti-nationalist, was trying to advance. His oft-quoted adage that the state has no business in the bedroom of the nation is perhaps a perfect embodiment of the liberal sentiment which Grant viewed as inimical to the Canadian character. If Pearson didn't kill Canada in Grant's eyes, Trudeau certainly did. Grant's fears of technology used to be more commonly shared in conservative circles, especially at the Catholic-predominated magazine like National Review. Russell Kirk called the automobile the mechanical Jacobin because of its individualizing and atomizing effect on society. Gary Numan wrote his song Cars for that reason. As he put it, "When you're in a car, your whole mentality is different. It's like your own little personal empire with four wheels on it." William F. Buckley Jr., when he campaigned for mayor of New York, proposed more bike lanes and more expensive toll booths in order to relieve traffic congestion by discouraging people from driving cars. Buckley himself preferred to ride his scooter. William F. Buckley also praised Walker Percy's dystopian novel Love in the Ruins, which he called an American equivalent to Orwell's 1984, and he saw it as a warning about, quote, what would happen if we didn't learn to control our technology. Today, Peter Hitchens laments the loss of Great Britain much the same way that Grant lamented the loss of Canada. And he points, among other things, to the proliferation of highways and automobiles as a significant cause of the loss of British rural character. He himself continues to ride a bicycle and self-identifies as a Puritan. Even in Alberta, the much-lauded conservative premier Peter Lougheed worried that the oil sands were being developed too quickly, concerns which went unheeded by his heirs. Grant was fully aware that he was on the, quote, wrong side of history, but he viewed the idea of history advancing towards a goal, the Whiggish view of history, as Butterfield called it, as an error in the first place, an error in some ways fostered by technology. If the goal of life is material self-improvement, then time is the history of the human race improving and working towards a goal. Again, it was a German, in this case Hegel, who in many ways invented the modern idea of a teleological society and history. Grant, on the other hand, believed, with Plato, that time was the moving image of an unmoving reality, a reality which had to be accessed through a mystical experience of faith, which Grant followed the French mystic Simone Weil in defining as intellect enlightened by love, hence the importance of the love of one's own. Grant's religious beliefs were obviously central to this. As a young man, he had been a pacifist during the Second World War, and as a volunteer, hurried people to safety. The brutality he witnessed during that war, the fruits of technology, nearly left him shattered and in despair until one morning, on his bicycle, he had a religious experience. It suddenly occurred to him that, quote, I am not my own. This was the opposite, he thought, of liberalism, which extolled the idea that I belong to no one but myself. This, according to C.S. Lewis, is the philosophy of hell. Indeed, Grant's conversion experience was similar to Lewis's, and Grant was actually a student of C.S. Lewis and met his wife Sheila in Lewis's Socratic Club. Sheila was from a Catholic background and had been a student of J.R.R. Tolkien, and the Inkling's philosophy inspired much of Grant's thought. One section on natural beauty and technology and justice is clearly inspired by the first chapter of Lewis's The Abolition of Man, and Tory's vision of traditional pre-technological society bears much in common with the anarcho-monarchistic imagination of the Inklings, many of whom, including Tolkien and Lewis, never learned to drive. Yet his apocalyptic vision of history seems to exclude the church as an active agent during the last days. Lewis's Space Trilogy sees Grace operative in this dystopian world, and Evelyn Waugh, who also had a pessimistic view of history, which has been compared to Orwell's, saw Catholicism as a force that would survive and struggle with the dystopia until the end. Of course, Catholicism has a stronger view of free will and of human history than Grant did. Newman's writings on the development of doctrine emphasize that the Church is a growing, organic body, active in permeating history and making grace active within it. Grant seems to have no place for that. In fact, in Philosophy in the Mass Age, he seems to favor the Church's cyclical liturgical year because it is outside the flow of history, and he explicitly cites Mercialiotti's notion of sacred time in defense of this, the idea of a mythic space apart from created historical space. This is just one of the ways in which Grant's nationalism seems more pagan than Christian. Note that he was a self-described Gnostic, which perhaps explains his bleak and hopeless vision of the human race. The documents of Vatican II, such as Gaudium et Spes, believe that the Church could influence the modern world to use technology to help communities rather than let communities be conquered by technology. Indeed, Pope Paul VI's writings about contraceptive mentality have a lot in common with Grant's warnings about technology. And while Grant held out a tentative hope that Catholicism could harness technology to a more human end, he thought it was more likely that Catholicism in a technologized world would resemble Catholicism in America, where cardinals like Cushing and Spellman seemed to sanction the U.S.'s imperialism, and where a Catholic president could try forcing nuclear weapons on Canada. But if Grant thought that the Church was not competent to arrest the spread of technology, it is not clear why he thought the state would be more effective. Perhaps this was part of his Anglicanism. Anglicanism, of course, has a long history of entanglement with the civil authority, often called Erastianism. In fact, in his loyalty to a nation, Grant was in many ways an heir to the conscious and calculated centralization of the nation-state which began at the Reformation, and replaced the organic medieval society with a modern technologized one. His project, therefore, seems utterly self-defeating, not only on a practical level, which he would have admitted, but also on an ideological level. Moreover, it is interesting to compare Grant to the Catholic distributists. G.K. Chesterton and Hilaire Belloc shared Grant's belief that the good life required the love of one's own, and for that reason, they advocated a widespread distribution of private property, so that everyone could have something to love of their own. Chesterton also defended a kind of nationalism which preserved the intransigency of local cultures, and for that reason he was a Zionist, believing that the Jews deserved a nation to be loyal to. He was also an advocate of Indian home rule. His essay on the matter greatly inspired Gandhi. And Grant, it should be noted, thought that Gandhi was the greatest figure of the 20th century. The Catholic convert E.F. Schumacher believed that technology could be harnessed for the service of communities and fought for what he called appropriate technology, which he saw embodied in the community and the work of Gandhi. Yet Grant's sprawling socialism is exactly what the distributists were trying to avoid. And as far as controlling technology goes, one wonders what Grant would have thought of Pope Francis, whose recent encyclical in some ways is a rebuke to what Grant identified as the technological ontology, which is called by the Holy Father the throwaway culture. Laudato Si is in many ways the heir to the Church's skepticism about technological process, not just in her social justice documents on the Industrial Revolution like Rerum Novarum, but also in actions like that of Pope Gregory XVI, who banned railroads from the Papal States because he thought they would foster liberalism and republican ideas. Or Robert Hugh Benson's dystopian novel Lord of the World, in which the final pope bans technology from the Vatican as the world slides into the abyss under the guidance of the Antichrist. You can count that novel, as well as Miller's Canticle for Leibowitz, as another example of depicting the Church as the last bastion in an apocalyptic world. Now, as a Catholic of English descent in Canada, I identify much with the situations described in the writings of Evelyn Waugh, which depicts English Catholics as a kind of British nationalism, even though by virtue of their Catholicism, they are at odds with the Anglicanism, which is part of the English ether, of the ethos. An English-Canadian Catholic may feel a bit like St. Edmund Campion after reading George Grant, and will want to retreat into Brideshead. So it is interesting to compare Grant to another Canadian who wrote about technology, Marshall McLuhan, who also identified how technology is an extension and modification of ourselves, and who was a devout Catholic. Like Grant, his insights into technology seem to dovetail with a high appreciation of liturgy. I want to conclude with a couple of points. One is the question of how the word Red Tory can be used. Now, some in England have tried to reappropriate it to refer to something like David Cameron's Big Society, not so much big business or big government, but more of the organic, community-driven control of technology. Now, Ron Dart, who is probably the leading scholar on Red Toryism in Canada, thinks that's an illegitimate use of Red Toryism. But if it is a valid use of the term, then perhaps it can be used to describe something like what Pope Francis has been calling for, which is an economy governed not so much by big business or by big corporations, but by cooperatives. The other thing I want to point out is that the next economy, in my opinion, the next big industrial shift will be mining asteroids, will be mining meteorites, will be mining other planets. That's the direction that we're headed. We have the opportunity for a whole new industrial revolution. And we have to wonder, is it going to be governed by the principles that governed the first industrial revolution? Many historians have pointed out the Cistercian monks of England were on the brink of an industrial revolution hundreds of years before it happened. And it would have been an industrial revolution driven more by the monastic principles of community, of self-denial, and of service. The dissolution of the monasteries prevented that industrial revolution from happening, and instead we got the one that we got. But we have the chance for a new industrial revolution, and what principles are going to govern it? I believe that a healthy version of Red Toryism is really important now, before we let our technology swallow us up again. We have a chance to use technology in the service of the whole universe, which is something the Holy Father is calling us to. Submit all that for your consideration. Take care and God bless.